This, and this has been shot on DV. Hello, my name is Mike, and today I'll be talking about the first consumer-grade digital video format that revolutionized amateur movie making, became an integral part of professional news gathering, and made an indelible impact on the Hollywood film industry. In 1993, Sony, Panasonic, JVC, Thomson, Philips, Hitachi, Toshiba, Sharp, Mitsubishi and Sanyo joined together to form HD Digital VCR Consortium. 1 year later, the consortium, which by that time grew to 55 companies, finalized the digital video cassette specification. The original DV specification stipulated two cassette sizes and a digital interface that allowed copying video from one tape to another or upload it to a computer without loss of quality. The digital interface was courtesy of Apple Computer. In 1995, DV video launched and FireWire became the standard protocol for transferring DV video between different devices. The ability to copy digital video losslessly attracted copyright protection watchdogs, and to keep the format alive, the idea of digital VCR was shelved, as it turned out, indefinitely. Only a couple of models were made. Large DV cassette, which was meant to replace VHS cassette and could hold over 4 hours of video, was repurposed for professional usage, while small or mini cassette was relegated for use in consumer-grade camcorders. Immediately after the launch, Panasonic, together with Bosch and Philips, introduced DVCPRO, a non-proprietary, as it has been stressed, video format for the production, broadcast, and distribution of digital video. Panasonic claimed that a professional version was needed because video tracks on the consumer-grade DV were too narrow to reliable editing accuracy. Timecode, as specified in the DV standard, was purportedly not frame accurate, and tape and cassettes were not robust enough for professional usage. Panasonic adopted large cassette, augmenting it with a medium-sized cassette for portable usage, and stipulated MP tape only. Panasonic also widened the recorded tracks to 18 micrometers, locked audio to video, and added SMPTE timecode. DVCPRO machines would play large cassettes with standard DV recordings, and even with DVCAM recordings that we'll talk about later. Small DV cassettes could be played with an adapter similar to a VHS-C adapter. Along with the fully featured ENG camcorder and studio videotape recorder, Panasonic promised an upcoming compact field recorder, laptop editing system, and high-speed player for streaming DVCPRO tapes at a speed 4 times faster than real-time to a nonlinear editing system. Such a faster than real-time digital video downloading is a standard practice today with modern file-based video formats, but was new 30 years ago. Next year, Panasonic integrated tape transport into a standard PC desktop machine, bundled it with editing software, and welcomed everyone to the future of video editing. In 1996, Sony responded with DVCAM, having tracks widened to 15 micrometers and with audio locked to video. Sony continued using small and large cassettes with ME tape. JVC took a different road, promoting Digital S as an answer for field and edit bay use. Digital S employed DV codec with double the bitrate and double the chroma resolution, recorded on half-inch tape in a VHS-sized cassette. In 1997, Panasonic presented its own DV variant with double bitrate, DVCPRO 50. Basically, Panasonic modified its machines to record Digital S on medium and large cassettes. The format was supported by Philips, and over the years became hugely popular for EFP. In 1998, Panasonic launched DVCPRO Progressive, prototype of which Panasonic presented a year earlier. Native progressive video better suited computer-based presentations and online video platforms. Several high-profile shows have been produced with it, and they still look great. As of 1998, Sony's attention started to switch towards MPEG-2, which was more advanced than DV. In 1999, Panasonic launched the much-anticipated DVCPRO HD equipment, also known as DVCPRO 100. The second half of the 1990s saw a rapid transition of video production to a network computer-based operation. In 1998, RAM price dropped to just 1/100th of 1992 price, while the capacity of hard disk drives continued to grow steadily. The giant magnetoresistive effect, GMR, discovered in 1988, culminated in developing of a high-capacity hard disk drive. For the first time, a single hard disk drive could store full content of a 60-minute DV cassette. Systems that started to ship in the mid-1990s allowed to edit DV natively at full resolution, but needed a whole farm of hard disk drives to store content just of a single tape. So new generations of hard disk drives allowed to whittle down the number of drives, and computer-based editing became affordable. In 1999, Sony ported DV to 8mm hardware, and it's interesting to compare 8mm cassette and medium-sized DVCPRO cassette. And as you can see, they're almost the same size, within a millimeter. The thickness is pretty much the same. The question arises, were it possible to reuse 8mm cassette for DV instead of creating a completely new family of cassettes?
And reportedly, this is exactly what Sony wanted to do. But the other DVC consortium companies flatly rejected this proposal, as they were afraid that using 8mm cassette and having the format backwardly compatible with all the Sony 8mm camcorders would give Sony an unfair advantage.
But just think about it, if Sony had its way, then the VX1000 would use 8mm tape.
Notice Digital 6 moniker on the first Panasonic MiniDV camcorder. Sony cheekily appropriated it for its new product called Digital 8.
In 1999, JVC, not being very successful with its digital half-inch equipment, presented professional DV based strictly on the consumer DV format, and JVC justified the professional DV moniker by using shoulder mount camera body in a combination with a decidedly consumer-grade tape transport. Sadly, JVC did not offer film-like frame rates on the DV500. Sony didn't bother much with film-like frame rates either, but for California porn producers and skateboard filmers, who were the major purchasers of the famed VX1000, this was not a deciding factor. The more real footage looked, was the better. This is why it saddens me when I see some recent remasters of old videos that have completely missed the boat. Take this remaster of an iconic skating video shot in 2003 on the VX. Do you notice anything wrong with it? How about this version, ripped from a DVD? Sure, the remastered version is more detailed, although nowhere close to 4K, but there is something more sinister going on. Let's compare both versions side by side. The remastered version has just half of the frames of the original video. What gives? The VX can only shoot at 30 frames per second interlaced. This means 60 distinct images, called fields, per second. Interlaced video looks fine on a CRT TV, but it must be converted for presentation on modern progressive scan TVs, for watching on a computer or YouTube, and the technical word is deinterlacing, and there are several ways of doing that. The most truthful method is converting each field into a complete frame, so you get 60 full frames from 30 interlaced frames. Whoever did the remaster either didn't know how to deinterlace correctly, or didn't care, or intentionally reduced image rate to achieve film look for what originally had live look. The film look craze reached a fever pitch 20 years ago, and everyone wanted their video to look like film, and using film-like frame rate is one checkbox in the long list of things needed to achieve film look. In 2002, Panasonic announced the AG DVX100 handheld camcorder, which could record with a film-like 24 frames per second rate. This was huge. The DVX injected fresh blood into DV format. converting it from something that amateurs used to shoot family videos and journalists used to shoot news pieces into the first affordable digital filmmaking format.
It looked as close to 16mm film as digital could look in the early 2000s. One may think that by mid-2000s, only cash-strapped filmmakers used DV to shoot movies, enter the BBC. In 2005, 1 year before BBC HD inauguration, the BBC filmed several TV series, including Rome and Space Race, with Panasonic DVCPRO 50 camcorders.
Быстро, быстро!
Panasonic continued developing the format, launching P2 solid-state media, and announcing that plans for DVCPRO P2 would follow the historical pattern of the DVCPRO 25, DVCPRO 50, DVCPRO HD tape-based format. As if recognizing that not everyone wanted to switch to tapeless workflow, especially at such high prices, Panasonic launched DVCPRO XL cassette in the same year it unveiled P2 card. The cassette, almost as large as a VHS cassette, allowed to record 2 hours of DVCPRO 50 and 4 hours of standard DVCPRO. In 2006, Panasonic launched DVCPRO HD EX, also known as DVCPRO HD LP, a long play version of DVCPRO HD. Sony also didn't want to abandon tape yet. In 2003, Sony, together with Canon, Sharp, and JVC, announced HDV, a consumer-grade HD format ported on DV hardware. Sony used both large and small cassettes, while Canon and JVC used small cassettes only. Sharp didn't produce any hardware. FireWire was used as a digital interface. It's worth noting that Panasonic engineers ensured that MPEG-2 packets could be sent over FireWire back in 1996. With the same track pitch and the same tape speed, you could have 1 hour of standard definition DV video or 1 hour of high definition HDV video on the same cassette. Throughout the 2010s, DV continued to be supported by Panasonic, Sony, and JVC on their tapeless equipment, P2, PD, S x S, memory stick, and SD cards. DV is still supported by major computer platforms and operating systems, unlike some other codecs that suffered during the transition from 32 to 64-bit technology in Mac OS. You can still shoot DV in the 2020s. The tape is no longer produced, but still available at places like eBay. And even at $5 per one cassette, it's cheaper than it was at the time of the launch. So take your old MiniDV camcorder out of a dusty box and go shoot some digital video on tape.